And we'll do all four verses. There's a little different wording in here, but I like it. All right, number 21.
Christ is our cornerstone, on Him alone we build. With His true saints alone, the courts of heaven are filled. On His great love, our hopes we place, of present grace and joys above. Oh, then with hymns of praise, these hallowed courts shall ring. Our voices we will raise, the three in one to sing, and thus proclaim in joyful song, both loud and long, that joyous name. Hear, gracious God, do Thou forevermore draw nigh. Accept each faithful vow, and mark each sob and sigh. In copious shower, on all who pray each holy day, Thy blessings pour. Here may we gain from Him the grace which we implore, and may that grace once given be with us evermore, until that day when all the blessed to endless rest are called away.
Amen. Boy, you guys sounded good tonight. All right, now none of you can ever say you've never sang that song. Amen. Boom. Good stuff. Right. That's another thing. Make sure you turn your cell phones on vibrate. Let's have a word of prayer. We're going to turn it right over to Pastor Haben, and we might go through that again a little bit later. We'll see. But, boy, good singing tonight, and then we're going to get straight into it. All right? First time's the worst time. Amen? We're already running a couple little things here and kind of ironing them out. I really appreciate you guys helping today, setting stuff up, and I'm excited about what's going to do. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, Lord, our Father, God, I ask that you please be with us. Lord, we're going to learn tonight about this thing called the church that we partake of for just a little part of our life. Lord, some of us have been in it ever since we were kids. Some of us have been in it, out of it, in it. Some of us just getting in it. Lord, I mean, I know once we got saved and became part of it, but understand this history of it. But it has gone through suffering, persecution, Lord, the havoc that it's gone through, as the Bible talks about. Lord, I pray that this history of it and Pastor Haben, Lord, would come together and beautify. And Lord, that we would walk out tonight and learn something. God, that would be glorifying through us, through our life. And Lord, individually, but also corporately as a local church here. Thank you for all you've done. We love you. And again, Lord, to give liberty as you have the love you in Jesus. We pray. Amen.
All right. Okay, where's that clicker?
So, on.
Yep.
That's the laser and just those two.
Yep. Okay. Well, good to be here tonight.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, take your Bible, please. We'll look at a couple things here. Go to Ephesians chapter 5. Yes, sir. Ephesians chapter 5. Now, if you date the church from the cross or the resurrection, you're looking at 1,984 years of history, and so it's a huge span, and The best we can do in an adjunct class like this is get an overview of the course of it, get a greater understanding of how we developed, how the church developed, get a greater appreciation for it, but you got to be really careful about getting bogged down in all the minutiae. It's 1,984 years, it's a million stories. And there's so many great stories, so many great people, so many great events. And you can't cover all of those things, but my goal in this type of class is just to give you a greater understanding and a greater appreciation, because I don't know about you, but a lot of people don't like history. You know, some of you probably, you hated history because your history teacher was probably the football coach and they needed to give him something else to do. You know, and so he said, guys, read the book, and he sat over there and read Sports Illustrated and then gave you the test, and, you know, that's no way to learn history. If you were lucky enough to have a good one, that's a blessing. But when it comes to the history of the church, it evokes the same images of boring dates and names and dates and places and things you have to kind of memorize and remember, and it seems very irrelevant. But it is relevant to us. Ephesians, they say go to Ephesians? Ephesians chapter 5. And look what it says in Ephesians chapter 5, and the pastor quoted it this morning. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the what? Church. So when you study the church, you're studying something that Christ loves. You're studying something that's important to God. And, you know, almost every epistle in the New Testament was written to a church. And the ones that weren't were written to individuals involved in a church. And God uses the church, and it's special to Him. Now, when we get into this thing, and you know, like, I don't know what your how many of you were raised Catholic? No dose. Okay, how about High Church Protestant, Episcopal, Anglican? Okay, how about Reformed, like Presbyterian? Anybody Presbyterian? All right, how about Methodist? How many of you never went to church? Uno. What's everybody? Pentecostal, Assemblies of God. All right, got a couple of Pentecostals. Mormon? Any Mormons in here? All right. Someone tell me one I missed.
Baptist.
Well, then what are you even doing here? All right. Okay, so you're raised Baptist. But when you're... my people on my mom's side were, go back one generation, they're all atheists. But then my grandma started going to a Methodist church as a kid by herself. She walked down the street, went to church, got saved. On my dad's side, Sicilian Catholics and Dutch Reformed for dozens of generations. When my parents got saved and they did not baptize my sister into the Catholic Church, my grandma freaked out. And it's a big deal. It's a big deal. And when some people think about the church, there's only one church. And that's the Roman Catholic Church. That's the church that they think that Christ founded, and everything else split off of that. And everyone else, and just so you know, all right, in the broad spectrum of Christianity, if you're a Baptist, you're like worse than the redheaded stepchild. You're worse than the cross-eyed, flipper-footed cousin that nobody talks about. We are fringe, right? And I'm talking about from the perspective of unsaved, quote-unquote, Christianity. And so almost all Christian or church history is written from the perspective that there's this great movement, this great church that other churches split off of. And it's the church that Christ founded, and they're talking about Catholic Church and its cousins, the Lutheran Church, the Presbyterian Church. And so to actually uncover our own history takes a little more work. Now, hey, it works. I always like this quote by Hegel, the only thing men learn from history is that men learn nothing from history. And one of the reasons it's important to study it is if you don't, you know, your Bible's written as a history book. It's not written as a religious book. It's not written mystically. It's written historically. And it makes no apology for the things that it records. And so when you, why do we read the Bible? Well, the things which were written aforetime were written for our learning. And so you learn from other people's mistakes. And that's why my little brother didn't get in as much trouble, because he watched me, you know. And, you know, you're supposed to get smarter by other people's mistakes. And the same would be true for Christian history. Now, how did we get here? Real quickly, in 37 AD, there's 200 in the upper room. Jesus Christ had a dozen close disciples. 200 in the upper room. Today there's, and this is as of 2015, I think, there's 2.5 billion, quote-unquote, Christians in the world. That's 1.3 billion Catholics. That's 900 million Protestants. And that'd be Lutheran and Anglican and Presbyterian and Methodist and that whole thing. There's another 280 million Eastern and Oriental Orthodox. And then there's another 35 million non-Trinitarian sects. You know, that'd be like Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and that kind of stuff. Every one of these groups claimed Jesus Christ as their founder. Every one of them traced their roots back to Jesus Christ. And by the way, every one of them thinks they're right. They all think they're right. And there's 100 million Baptists in the world. There's 280 million Pentecostals. There's 90 million Lutherans. There's 80 million Reformed churches, and on and on and on. And they all claim Christ as their father. And as far as, you know, where we're at, we still have these guys here on the left. See that guy with the fish head on it on the top of him there, and the Halloween suit, the costume? And anyways, I'm not going to say anything else. But we still have, you know, to a lot of people, this is still church. When they think of church, this is what they think of. They think of going somewhere and not understanding anything that the guy says. And they think it's all ritual, and they think it's all irrelevant. And we have these guys, and we now have these guys. And this is what a lot of people think church is now. And so when we talk about church history, what are we talking about? Are we talking about some dead formal ritualism passed down for generations that just supports a bunch of, you know, old shriveled up celibates or supposed celibates? Or are we talking about this right here? This is supposed to be authentic, you know, these guys, you know, moshing it, you know, that kind of stuff. What is it? What is the church? When we talk about the history of the church and compared to world history is thought of in three periods. Now, you might remember this from school. It's divided up into three periods. Can everybody see this, by the way? Good. All right, you got ancient, and that's early civilization, you know, where you start in Babylon and Egypt and that kind of stuff from the Fertile Crescent, and all the way to the fall of Rome. In the 5th century. And then there's medieval history, which is the fall of Rome to the discovery of America. And then there's modern history, 15th century to today. Quite simply, church history can be thought of into three periods. There's the ancient or Roman era. And the first era is the time of Christ, and that's about 33 AD to the fall of Rome, the 5th century. And the second section is the medieval era. You know, with the knights and the castles and the moats and, you know, Lady Guinevere and all that stuff. And from the fall of Rome to the Reformation. And then the third period is the Reformation to where we're at today. And if you look at these periods, the early church, and this is just a broad overview here, but the early church from 33 AD to the fall of Rome, during this time, Christianity generally spread within the area of Greek and Roman influence. So Jerusalem fell to Rome in 30 AD, and the four Greek kingdoms essentially got absorbed by Rome. And if you look at the Roman Empire, let's come down here. Let's do it like this. Let's put the Levant right here and come down here and come up like this, and all right, so this is Africa. Now you guys know where we're at, kind of, right? Just like the winds down in Africa. Okay, you got it? And then you come over here. Thank you. You know, okay, and then come up here in the Mediterranean. We got modern day Turkey, but in the Bible it was called Asia. And you come up here into the Black Sea, and you got the Bosphorus Straits and the Dardanelles, and then And you got the Aegean in here and all the islands, and Hillary Clinton and the island of Lesbos. And then you come over here and you got, sorry. You're going to get extra stuff once in a while. It's just the way it goes. And then you got Greece, and then, you know, you got the boot, you know, and all the crazy people that are horrible drivers and chauvinistic, you know, and this kind of stuff. And then you got to come down here, and you got, you know, the Iberian Peninsula, blah, blah, blah. Okay, go up here and France, and then you got merry old England and fish and chips and Robin Hood and, you know, and then you got the drunken Isles of Ireland and, you know. You kind of know where I'm at now? Does everybody know where I'm at? Okay, come up here, you got Jutland, and then come down here, and you got, oh, these countries no one cares about, and Norway and Sweden and all that stuff. Scandinavia. Okay, now I know that's not really to scale, but you, do you know kind of where we're at now? You kind of, okay, so then I'll go, bring our Nile up here like this, and then we'll put the Dead Sea here and Sea of Galilee here and put Jerusalem right there. And then you come over here and you got the Euphrates and the Tigris and Babylon and then you've got the Arabian Peninsula and Persian Gulf and that kind of stuff. You go way over here and you got the Indian subcontinent, and now you kind of know where we're at, right? All right, so Roman Empire, obviously, at its zenith, you know, came over into here, all of this, absorbed all the Egyptian kingdoms, wiped out Hannibal, Carthage, all of North Africa, all of Spain, at one point made it all the way up to Hadrian's Wall there in Brittany, never really conquered all of Germany, couldn't quite beat the Goths up there, and eventually these people came out of here around here and sacked Rome. Okay, but the Roman Empire, generally, this is it right here. All right? And that was the known world if you're Roman, and they spoke Latin, but mostly Greek. Mostly Greek. Greek was the educated language of a lot of this area until you got up into the vulgar tongues. This is what you called the heathen. These were when Paul referred to the heathen, he wasn't referring to these people, right? You got the library at Alexandria. Those are the smartest people in the world. He wasn't referring to this area. This is all settled by Greeks. All right? They had Socrates and Plato and Aristotle. All right? He wasn't referring to this area. This is where Babylon and Persia were from. And this area here, these people had indoor plumbing and knew how to clean themselves while your people were still swinging from trees and sacrificing to the sun god. And way ahead of white man, way ahead of them. And these people are civilized. And when the Bible talks about the barbarians, you know what he's talking about? He's talking about your ancestors, right? That fought for a living, wanted to die in battle so they could go to Odin's Hall and drink ale out of curved horns. All right? That's what they wanted. And that's your people. How many of you got German blood in you? Yeah, okay. The rest of you are lying. How many are Irish in here? Yes! Yeah. Lowest form of white man there is. Yeah. Anyways. Scotch-Irish is low. All right, anyways. So if you if you look at this area here, now in the first part of Christianity, because of the connectivity of the Roman Empire, obviously Rome's right here, okay, because of the connectivity of the empire, both linguistically with roads and these type of things, it was easy for Christianity to spread throughout the Roman Empire, where once you got onto the frontier where Rome hadn't conquered, you had to deal with different languages, you had to deal with different government, you had to deal with people unfriendly to you, just nationalistically, which, by the way, is the reason that American missions has been able to go all over the world. Because for a long time, America was respected. Yeah. Right? Or feared, which is the same thing in a lot of cultures. And so Christianity in the first 500 years, it spread mainly within the Hellenistic or the Greek and the Latin world. Now, and you know this because your pastor's taught you this, but if you look at this, of course, this is where Jesus Christ died. And Jesus Christ died in the center of the universe as far as God's concerned. And he died in Asia Minor. He died in the French call it the Levant. And it's the center of the universe. Up here you have Noah's oldest son, Japheth. And over this way, you got his middle son, Shem. And down here, you got his youngest son, Ham. And right at the crossroads of all those cultures is where God sent his son. Right? So in Acts chapter 8, the Ethiopian eunuch gets saved. And in Acts chapter 9, Paul gets saved, a Jew. And in Acts chapter 10, Cornelius, the head of the Italian band, yeah? Giuseppe, right? The pasta eaters, he got saved. That's right. God got them all. He got them all. Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And that's where Christianity started. Right in the middle of the universe where God's son was born and ministered and died and rose from the dead. Now, I'll use this a little bit here tonight, but I just want you to see that. Now, that's where Christianity spread initially. Now, when you go into the next era, when we talk about the medieval church, that's the fall of Rome, 476, at least that's when Odoacer sacked it, to the Reformation. That's the middle part of the church. Christianity is established. It's established in Europe, East Asia, North Africa, and the Middle East. And so during this period, all right, that's why you have, anybody heard of the Coptic Church? All right, that's Coptic. That's Egyptian. That's an Orthodox Egyptian church. Okay, you have the Armenian Orthodox Church. All right, that's the Christian Church for Armenia. You have Iranian Orthodox, right? You have Greek Orthodox. You have Slavic or Russian Orthodox, right? You have Georgian Orthodox. You have all these different Christians, and it became established in these areas, in Europe, in East Asia, in North Africa, and the Middle East. However, the first few hundred years, Christianity spread a lot faster than it did in the Middle Ages. Because after the fall of Rome, a lot of the world broke down as far as their interactions with each other. And it wasn't really into the Crusades until a lot of that opened up. And so Christianity spread a lot slower. You know what they say? They say you can't fight economics. Right? And that's just the truth of it. And, you know, Christianity didn't spread like it did in the early era until Europeans started going all over the world. And when the Redcoats got on those ships and sailed all over the world, sometimes missionaries got on the boats with them. And so in the medieval era, Christianity didn't spread as fast, and it actually went this way. And the Novatians made it all the way to modern day Indonesia in the 7th century, and they went to China, and they went to the Southeast Asia, but most of them were killed. Most of them were killed. And not only that, but in the 7th century, there was a fornicating pedophile, born down here in Medina. His name was Muhammad. And he started a religion, Muhammadism or Islam, you know. And this whole area went Muslim. Now, my personal opinion is that was God's judgment on idolatry, but I'm not going to really mess with that. Okay? Now, I'm showing you this for a reason. Okay? Christians did go to China. The Apostle Thomas has said, I was at a chapel where they say Thomas was speared in the first century in India, in Chennai, according to church tradition. They did go this way. Okay? Peter said, the church that is at Babylon salutes you. Right, so Christianity did initially go east, but it was wiped out. It was rejected in the Orient, and they were completely obliterated by Islam in the 6th to the 10th centuries, for the most part. Some semi-kinoclastic cultures held on, no doubt about it. But as far as its spread and its power, Islam really overtook this part of the world. Now, I said all that to say this. That means that after this, Christianity primarily became a European religion. Okay? Now, you got, I don't know how many reservations you got here, but I grew up in North Dakota and Montana, and if I've heard it once, I've heard it 1,000 times. I've said, I've heard it, it's the white man's religion. How many ever heard that? Maybe you talk to a Hindu and he says Christianity is a European religion. Yeah, you know, I've had Blackfeet and Assiniboine and Crow and also all sorts of them have told me that that's a white man's book. It's not a white man's book. Every book in that Bible was written by a Semite. He's written by an Oriental. There wasn't one book in that Bible written by a pale face, except maybe Malachi. I think he was Italian. But I'm trying to get him in there. I'm trying. That's not a white man's book. It's not written in a linear fashion. It spirals. It's written cyclically. He tells you the creation story in Genesis 1, and then he repeats it in Genesis 2. That's how an Oriental writes. That's not how a Westerner writes. A Westerner writes in a straight line. That's an Eastern book from start to finish. Now, and so when you hear this, I'm telling you why Christianity became a white man's religion. Okay? It became a white man's religion because everywhere else it got wiped out. Yeah. All right. Paul said, I'm a debtor both to the Greek, the educated, and to the barbarian, both to the wise and to the unwise. And so that is one of the main reasons that Christianity primarily became a white man's religion is because it survived in Europe. Or didn't survive other places. And that's just something to note. Okay, you get that? You get that? And I'll tell you more about that momentarily. Okay, now in the modern era, which is the Reformation to the present, Christianity then follows European expansion and is established worldwide. Okay, and so Christianity didn't spread very much beyond where it was until after the Reformation, geopolitically, Europeans started exploring, and then when the New World opened up, and you know Magellan sailing around the Cape and Vasco da Gama, and you know the whole thing. You learned this all in history. The world became opened up to Europe. Now they were fine over there. I'm sure they were fine over there without us. But we discovered them, and when we discovered them, a lot of times missionaries went along with them, which is why there were British missionaries to China and India and all of Africa. And that's when Christianity really spread, is when all these guys, Cook and Drake and Columbus and all the European explorers for 3 centuries opened up the world to Europe. A lot of times missionaries came with them. And that's when Christianity really moved around the world. And now you can't go anywhere where Christ, where someone hadn't told someone about Christ at some point, outside of a few pockets. Look at Acts chapter 16. And like I said tonight, I'm just trying to give you an overview, a bird's eye view of the progression of the church, and hopefully it'll make sense to you. In Acts chapter 16, this is the other reason. This is the other reason. You say, why is Christianity historically European? Well, here's your answer. Look at Acts chapter 16. All right, now here's the apostle to the Gentiles. And look what it says in verse 5. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. Now when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia. All right. So here's Paul. And you know what Paul did? Paul based out of Antioch, right? He based out of Antioch. And he made his missionary journeys through this area. Okay? And that was called back then Asia. Okay? Now you understand that we call all of this Asia now. But I want you to see something interesting here. What's it say there? Bithynia and Phrygia? Is that what he says? Are those the places that he went through? Okay, that's right here. Okay? That's right here. So he's right here. Okay? Which means right across the water is Europe. Right across the water. This separates this world from this one. Now, look what it says in verse 6. It says, and when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden, look what it says, of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in what? So they're there and they're preaching and the Lord shuts them down. You say, why?
I don't know.
I'm just telling you that's what he did. Okay, why'd he call Abraham and not some other idol worshiping heathen? I don't know. Okay, but I have some theories. Okay, but they were forbidden. He says, you're done in Asia. Okay, now someone read. Someone keep reading.
After they were come to Mysia, they had safely gone to Bithynia, but the Spirit of something.
Okay, Mysia, right here. And what's it say? Read it again. Bithynia, right here. Okay? And the Spirit, what? Why? I don't know. Yeah, there you go. Keep reading.
And they passed by Mysia, came to Troas.
Okay, Troas. Right here. It's on the straits. That narrow passage in between Thrace and Asia Minor. There it is. You know why you're saved? Because of that dream right there. That's why I'm saved. He could have stayed over here. Right? But the Lord said, no, I want you to go over there. So he goes over to Macedonia. That's where Alexander the Great's dad was from, Philip of Macedon. He goes over and he starts preaching on the European mainland. And he goes all through here, and he ends up losing his head in Rome, but not before he'd gone into Spain. And some legend has it that he crossed the channel and made it all the way up here. But that's where your people are from, right here. If you're Norwegian, British, Danish, French, Northern Italian, Spanish, if you're Romanian, if you're from part of Poland or Czechoslovakia or Germany or Denmark or Norway or Sweden, or all these people, these Germanic people, all these people were called barbarians. And Paul made it all the way up to these folks. And it's because of that dream right there. God said, don't go this way anymore. I want you to go this way. And so that's how Christianity became a European religion. For more than one reason. And, now let's look at something else here. You get that? Does that make sense? All right. Sometimes it's as simple and complicated as that. Now, another way you can track the progress of Christianity is you could even track it through Bible versions. So in the 4th century, Ethiopia and Egypt got a Bible. And in the 4th century, it was in Italic and Gothic. And in the 5th century, it was translated into Armenian. And then the 9th century, it was translated into Slavic. And in the 14th century, it was translated into Frankish, which is a Germanic language. And then the 16th century, it's translated into German. And then it's translated into English in the 15th and 16th. And then it's translated into the Spanish in, I think, the 16th or 17th. And then it's way over here. It's all the way over here. I think it made it to Malay in maybe the 18th, and maybe the Japanese in the 18th, and it was translated into Afghan in the 19th century, and now you're all the way back. And so what you have is the course, even of Bible translation, has followed an east-west path. History moves east to west, just the way it is. And so you can see that. And today, probably, if you, it'd be real close, but I wouldn't doubt if South Korea has more Christians per capita than the United States now. And there's 100 million professing Christians in China now. And even while most people in Europe are either professedly agnostic or atheist. And those are the nations that gave the world the Bible. Isn't that crazy to think about? It's crazy to think about, but that's the way it goes. Okay, now let's keep going. I'll give you a couple more minutes to take a break here. All right, why study church history? We already said it. It's something that Christ loves. And if God's interested in it, I should be interested in it. I already read this. Those who refuse to study the mistakes of the past are condemned to repeat them. We learn from history. Another interesting thing is that church history is fulfilled prophecy in front of your face. In other words, the Lord made a lot of predictions of things that would happen to the church depending on what we did and how we handled his word. And so a lot of times what you can see is you can see obedience to the Lord and to his word and what happens, and disobedience to the Lord and his word and what happens. And so because the whole Bible's prophecy, you can actually see it play out. And so it's fulfilled prophecy right in front of your face. You can see the word of God in action. And not only that, but history becomes a way to view the present and the future. Solomon said, "The thing that hath been is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun." And that is the truth. That is the truth. And so a lot of times we can learn for the present by viewing the past. And we should. Now, there we go. Now, what is the church? I'm going to cruise over this because you're in a good Bible-believing church, and you know this. What is the church? You know that the church in the Bible can mean one of two things, right? Right? What can it mean? Well, it can mean all the saved. The body of Christ. That means anybody that's ever been saved, right? Ephesians 1:22. The church which is his body. However, we know this. We know that most of the time that we see the term church in the Bible, it's not referring to that, is it? Right? We know that everyone that's saved is in the church, but we also know that for all practical purposes, when he talks about the church, this is the church. Right? And let's face it, it's pretty hard to track the invisible church. But we can track the visible church. All right? And so it's a local body of believers. Now, what's the perversion of this? The perversion of this is that the church is every member of an earthly visible organization under a pope. That's the perversion of this right here, all the saved. You see, it makes everyone that's been baptized part of that universal church, and then it puts a head over that church, which is with his headquarters in Rome and a half a grapefruit on his head. And we know that that's not biblical. And now, the term, you ever heard this term right here, Christendom? All right, that's you see Christ, right? You see that? And then you see dumb, D-O-M, like dominion. Not dumb, like dumb. Like dominion. Like dominate, right? Christendom, okay? It means the universal kingdom of Christianity. That's a general term that I don't tend to use, but it just means all the saved under Christ. It means the general advancement of God's kingdom on earth, which we don't look at it that way. Now, some church history is more Christian history, and some Christian history is more church history, and really a lot of it isn't either. When you get into a lot of the, and this is, you know, if you go to, well, I say if you go to Barnes & Noble, I don't even know if there's any Barnes & Noble left, but when you look at the history of the church, they're just going to give you a long history of popes and edicts and conferences, and doesn't really have much to do with the Bible church at all. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. This will be a good place to take a break. We'll look at this, and then we'll take a break. Are you still with me? Okay, good. I'm cruising right now. I want to get into the meat of the thing, but it's good to have this perspective going in, okay? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians, I don't know, what do my notes say? Okay, then that, follow the notes. Follow the written word over me every time. Okay. 1 Thessalonians 1, okay? The Bible shows us how to follow the visible church. Now, you know people and I know people. You ask them what church they're a part of, and they say, I'm part of the universal church. Which I always like to ask them, well, where do you tithe? I bet it's yourself, right? And so, yes, there is a universal church. But for all practical purposes, you can only follow the history of the church through the history of local congregations. Let's be real here. Okay? And I know there's exceptions to that. But as a general rule, that's how it works, okay? So the Bible shows us how to follow the visible church. What do you mean by that? What is a church? Is it a social club? Is it a local aid organization that helps out the poor? Is it, what is it? What are the characteristics of a Bible church? Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, or 1. And that's that DayQuil. For our gospel, Miss Rose gave it to me. Blame her. She's a heavy hitter, man. I'll tell you what. She's got a liver like a horse, I think. I'm a lightweight. 1 Thessalonians 1, look at verse 5. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power. All right? So it's not just a profession. There's power behind it. And in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake, and you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that you were in samples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. For from you, now look what it says, from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only into Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God were to spread abroad. And a mark of the early church is its baptized believers that openly confess Christ. There was always open confession. It wasn't a secret disciple thing. It wasn't baptizing some kid as a little baby and telling them, yeah, you got saved when you were one, you see. They're baptized believers that openly confess Christ. And they had a worldliness. Paul said this. He said, look what it says here in verse 9, for they themselves showed us what manner of entering in we had unto you, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. There was an aversion to worldliness and pagan religion. One of the ways you can pick out a church from an organization masquerading as a church is that when a person gets saved, they're encouraged to leave their idols behind. And a lot of pseudo-Christian religions just absorb the religions of the people that they conquer and mix them in. And look, I can say this, okay? I got family up the wazoo that's Catholic and Lutheran and Methodist, so if you get offended at me talking about other religions, it's going to be a rough week, okay? And I got family in a lot of different religions, and I love them dearly, so don't get me wrong here. But doesn't mean I agree with them. And that's why the Catholic Church looks completely different in Mexico than it does in the U.S. And it looks different all over the world. And that's why on the Rocky Boy and the Blackfeet Reservation there in Montana, the priest goes into the sweat lodge and burns sage with you. He doesn't care, as long as you stay loyal to the church. He doesn't care. He'll mix that junk right with Christianity. Doesn't even matter. And they'll mix idols with it. No problem. No problem. And there's a long history of that. How long is that history? Well, that's where infant baptism comes from. Infant baptism started heavily in North Africa when people who had, in North Africans had a ritual of cleansing their children and dedicating them at an early age. And the bishops in North Africa took that pagan practice, that pagan cleansing dedication, and then baptized them into the church so that they could still keep their pagan practice while professing to be Christians. That started right here. They got a long history of that. A long history of that. Now look what else. He says this. He says in verse 9, "For they themselves show us what manner of entering in we had into you, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God." Look at 1 Thessalonians 2:13. He says this, "For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the what? Word of God." Another earmark of a true a church is the word of God is the sole rule book for faith and practice. Not the sayings and quips and quotes of a bunch of dead guys, but the word of God. And the traditions and the writings of the church fathers for a Bible believing church are not equal to the Word of God. They don't win place or show, and that's not true for a lot of churches, right? You've seen the commercials on TV; they'll show it. They'll put the Bible down, and then they'll flop the Book of Mormon down right on top of it, and they'll flop the teachings of the 12. And the doctrines and covenants, and it'll go over that book. You see, Paul says it's not the word of men, it's the word of God. It's the word of God. Now look what he says in 1 Thessalonians 5:10. He says this, excuse me, 1 Thessalonians 1:10, "And to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead." Another earmark of a true church is it's an expectation of an heavenly kingdom with a peculiar indifference to the temporal one. And that's why even in communion, Paul said, you do show the Lord's death till what? Till he come. One more, and then we'll take a break. Look at Acts 11. And look what it says here. Now, here's another earmark of the Christian church, is that they're named by their enemies. Right? No Baptist ever named the Baptist church. Okay? Right, look what it says in Acts 11:26. "And when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch, and it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people, and the disciples were called" what? Sure. Right. Christians. You're named by your enemies. You know what they said? These guys are following Christ, so they call them Christians. Right? They're named by their enemies. Right? So it's, look at this. Luther. Lutherans. They didn't name themselves Lutherans. Their enemies named them Lutherans. They associated them with a name, then they tried to run down the name so they could straw dummy everybody. Right, here's another one, right? Wesleyans. What would that be? Wesleyans Methodists, followers of Wesley. That goes on and on and on and on. That thing goes all the way through. And so they're named. They're named by their enemies. Now you, you're a Baptist. All right, but they used to be called Anabaptists. Anabaptists, named by their enemies. And that means to re-baptize. And that was not, when you were called an Anabaptist, that was not a compliment. All right, not a compliment at all. Why? Because when you dunked an adult in water, you just told them that the guy down at the church where your family's buried and you get the sacrament where you were married, that what he sprinkled on you when you were a kid, right? In nomine patri, in spiritu sancto, all this stuff. When he did that, it didn't do anything. Right? I mean, seriously. And this was a perjurative name right here. This was not a compliment. Baptist, named by their enemies. John the Baptist. Someone else called him that. You see? And Trumpians. Oh, no. I just... All right, we need to take a break. Take a break. All right. All right.
want white, yeah, for sure.
Thank you.
So I mentioned that the church history is fulfilled prophecy in front of your face. I think it's pretty obvious in 2021 that as a whole, the church is not anywhere near what God intended it to be. Okay? I don't think God intended the church to ordain homosexuals. Right? I don't think God intended the church to be a place where you could go week after week and never hear how to be saved. Right? And we could go on and on and on. The church was never intended to be a business, for that matter. And it sure is in a lot of places. And you can go, and so I think we don't have to spend a lot of time talking about how we are at a place where the church has definitely strayed from what it should be. I think, though, that what's important to realize is that that was prophesied, that it would happen. Also, that it's nothing new. And I'll tell you the pitfall with this, and I'll tell you where people get into trouble. There's a movement right now in our society toward authenticity. Okay, people are reacting to being raised on pablum and margarine. Remember the margarine where you actually broke open the dye and mixed it in, right? That's not butter, you know that, right? Right, and so people are reacting to the fake, even to the point of they'll go to a church and they sing the same songs over and over and they're not getting any Bible. Right, and so there's a whole movement in our society because we're so detached from each other, and there's so much technology that people don't have a lot of human interaction, and they're just seeking really what it means to be human. And so that can go, I mean, and that can be all sorts of stuff. That can just be like, you know, think globally, you know, eat locally, right? Or all my vegetables I'm going to buy from the organic garden down the road, and I'm going to brew my beer from hops grown in this valley. And, you know, I mean, that's right. There's microbreweries every now, right? Every shutdown machine shop is now making booze, you know? And, you know, why? Because it's local. This is, right, this is local. This is authentic, right? Right? No, I don't, never mind. But that's, what is that? That's people looking for something real is what it boils down to. And a lot of times, so let me tell you what happens, is a guy starts reading, and if there's ever a minefield, it's church theology and church history. The majority of church theology and church history is written by amillennial Calvinists. And when you get done reading them, you'll be deader than, as Doc used to say, deader than a hammerhead on the beach on the 4th of July. And it's a real minefield. And so what happens is people start reading this stuff and they assume that that's what Christians used to be like. Okay, let me tell you something. Do you know any Christians that are weirdos? They're just, why is it that churches attract weirdos more than any other place? Especially Baptist churches. We have more weirdos. And I don't know if it's because we have an inviting environment, right? All right, So if there's weirdos in church now, you don't think there were weirdos in church in the 15th century? Just because somebody wrote some poem, you know, while they were having a manic fit, doesn't make them more spiritual than someone today. People have always been the same. And so a lot of times what people do is they start reading and they start trying to find what is that true church. But before long, you're basically having church at home, right? Because that's what they did in the Bible. That's what they didn't do. They might have met in houses, but they had a pastor, and they were organized, and there was authority. And so, but people in that search for authenticity and realness, oftentimes what you find is you find leftover junk. And I want to tell you something. The people that gave you this Bible and the people that preach the church, they're hard to find. You want to know why they're hard to find? Because everything they wrote was burned. And they were burned on top of it. They took their books and lit the fire that burned them. And what you got left is, it's just like this. Imagine 500, let's just say there's an earthquake right now. And it covers this whole town. Okay? And 500 years from now, okay, some Chinese guy excavates Lewistown, and he finds the Christian bookstore. And he goes into the Christian bookstore, and what he finds there, he then judges true Christianity 500 years ago by what he finds in that Christian bookstore. He'd be off. And that's what happens when people that don't know what they're doing start studying this stuff. There's a lot of CRAP out there. I don't know how else to say it. Okay? Now, you following me? Now, I want to show you this. Okay? And now we know this. All apostasy begins with questioning the words of God. That's where it started. A good example, that's the Garden of Eden. They're in a perfect place, and everything's going fine. And the devil says, yea, hath God said. Okay? And that word apostate means to fall away from a standard position. The nature of church history, look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. The 1 Timothy chapter 2. When we follow church history, okay, from you sounded out, he said, and so we follow, well, the history of the church is the history of the gospel. All right? I mean, isn't that what our founder said before he went back to heaven? Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, and the othermost parts of the earth. If he says that's what you're supposed to do and that's what's going to happen, then that's what we should look for. We should look for the spread of the gospel. Okay, look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4. And the Bible says about God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. That hasn't changed. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. God still wants people saved. And look what Paul says about his own ministry in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 16. He says this, to preach the gospel in the regions beyond you. And biblical Christianity has always looked to get the gospel out. And not to boast another man's line of things made ready in our hand. And so the history of the nature of church history is the spread and the effect of the gospel in the world. And the gospel still changes people, and it always has. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. My dad was led to the Lord by a Lutheran farmer with a Gideon Bible. He wasn't a pastor. He wasn't a deacon. He didn't go to Bible college. He was a farmer living in the middle of nowhere. My dad stole a radio from him, and the cops caught him because he was drunk out of his mind and high, and they brought him to the house, and that man said, I don't care about that radio. I care about you, and he sent the sheriff home, and he took my dad at 2 in the morning into his kitchen table, and there under the dining room light, he opened the Word of God, and my dad trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior. He didn't go to Bible college. His dad wasn't a Baptist. His dad wasn't some great man of faith. I don't even know if his parents were saved. He's just someone that loved Jesus Christ and had a Bible. That's how it spreads, right? It spreads through the truth. It spreads through the preaching of the Word of God. That's how it's always spread. And anywhere the gospel shows up, there's power. Anywhere. Okay? And why is that important? Because this is the other pitfall in studying church history, is the need for succession. Okay? The need for succession. And what do you mean by that? I got to prove I'm authentic. Okay? Just like when you go to an Italian's house, they got to tell you, this is my grandma's recipe, and it came from the old country, and they don't do it right in Olive Garden. Right? You know what real carbonara is? It's eggs and pancetta and, right, and Parmesan, that's it. Nothing else. You put mushrooms in it, you ruin it. Right, you know what I'm talking about. All right? Everybody wants to be authentic, right? And we all want to trace our roots back somewhere. So the Catholic Church, right, follows a line of popes that they say go all the way back to who? Peter. Well, we know that's not true, right? Peter was never in Rome, and Peter was married. He didn't make a very good first pope. Right? Okay? But everybody feels like they have to show a line of unbroken succession in order to make church authentic. Okay? And it's the myth of what we call apostolic succession. right? Where the authority of the was then passed down to their successors or their disciples and passed down to them, right? So Peter baptized someone who baptized somebody who baptized somebody who baptized somebody who baptized somebody who baptized you, and that puts you in the real church. And that's hogwash. Okay? And but there's the need for that. Somehow people think they're authentic if they can trace a line, and the Baptists do the same thing. They try to trace you all the way back to John the Baptist. Well, that's a mess. John the Baptist wasn't even in the church. So that's a mess. That's just a mess right there. And we don't have time to get into that. And so what a guy will do is he'll force stuff. He'll force stuff in order to prove that authenticity. And you got to be really careful about that, because that's not how it works. It's a history of the spread and the effect of the gospel of the world. I'll give you an example. Here's Martin Luther. He's in his second year of divinity school in Germany. He's 20 years old. He's in his second year of Bible college, and he's never laid eyes on a Bible. Yeah, that's the Catholic Church in the 15th and 16th centuries. Can you believe that? Don't even give their people the Word of God. The first time he reads a word out of that book, he's 20 years old. And he starts reading. And he reads a verse, "The just shall live by faith." And he's racked with guilt over his sin, and he can't sleep at night. And he's pulling his hair out and crying and waking up in sweats. And he talks to another monk there, another priest there at the where he was studying the Bible. And that priest looked at him and he says, "I got the same problem." And he says, "Nothing the church has ever said has done any good." He says, I just keep going over and over in my mind. I believe in the forgiveness of sins." And he pointed him to Christ. Well, within a couple, one day, Martin Luther's crawling up the steps of a cathedral doing penance. Penance is where you punish yourself for your sin. They did all sorts of stuff. They'd take a whip, and Sir Thomas More used to call it flagellation. They'd whip their back, and he'd scars all over his back. Martin Luther's would crawl on the floor till his knees were bloody, trying to pay for his own sins. See what happened? A verse came to his mind: "The just shall live by faith." And he got a hold of that thing and finally trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior, and he was saved. Right? He wasn't led to the Lord by a Baptist. It was led to the Lord by a Baptist that was baptized by a Baptist that went all the way back to Paul. It just doesn't work that way. The succession is not through a person with a magic touch. Although sometimes that it is through a person, you understand. The succession is the Word of God. Right? And you can plant the Word of God in a desert and just a little bit of rain and it'll bloom. And it's always good to remember that. Now, God uses us. We need to understand that. But don't try to find an unbroken line of succession. It probably is there, but you'll be very frustrated. Okay, does that make sense? All right. A history of the teaching and fruit of revealed doctrine in believers. Look at Ephesians chapter 3. Look at Ephesians chapter 3. You guys like my retro red hair to Eve in the garden? I had to put her up there. She's great. Ephesians chapter 3. I don't know if Eve had red hair, but Ephesians chapter 3. And look at verse 9. "And to make all men see," what does Paul say? Well, verse 8. "Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see," now this is interesting, "what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hidden God, who created all things by Jesus Christ." Paul says this: my ministry is A, to preach the gospel, but B, it's to reveal what happened to you when you did get saved. And so the history of church is not only the history of the gospel, but it's a history of the teaching and the fruit of right doctrine. Now, thirdly, and this is important, look at 1 Timothy chapter 4. Okay? Because, you know, like the laws of physics, right? For every action, there's an equal reaction. What goes up must come down, right? Carbon monoxide follows a line of cars down the Santa Ana Freeway, right? That's just nature, right? Which means what? Means, thirdly, the history of the church is also a history of apostasy. Right? It's the oldest story in the world. Things start out good, and we screw it up. Seriously. Every stinking time. Every single time. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly, then in the latter time some shall depart from the faith. So don't be alarmed that people are departing from the faith. Paul said it would. Paul said it would. The history of the church is the history of apostasy. And now we're going to see this and we'll get into this, but not tonight. And just remember this, that all apostasy begins with questioning and replacing the Word of God. Every single time you can take that to the bank, that's where it starts. Because all correct doctrine and truth is based on the Word of God. You get rid of the Word of God, you get rid of all of it. And now look at Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11. I call this a cycle of revival and decline. And look at Romans chapter 11. And in Romans chapter 11, let's see here. I want to show you this really quick, and then we'll get back here. There it is. Look at Romans chapter 11. And look at verse 13. Romans chapter 11, verse 13. And look what Paul says. He says this, "For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I'm the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify mine office." Paul says, I'm the apostle of the Gentiles. Look at Romans 15. And this is where people get all messed up. They get all messed up. Look at Romans chapter 15, and look at verse 15. "Nevertheless, brethren, I have written the more boldly unto you in some sort, as putting you in mind, because of the grace that is given me of God, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost." It's very clear, okay, what is that God gave New Testament doctrine to the Apostle Paul. He did. He gave it to Paul. And Paul said, "Follow me as I follow Christ." What then is the history of the church? The history of the church right from the get-go is a history of falling away from the Word of God as revealed to Paul. And I'm going to show you this. Now, the work of God starts with a man. It always does. And then his following, he gains a following and leads a movement. And you'll see this over and over. And it's developed and organized into a machine. And then it's filled with unbelieving, upholding the fundamentals as a monument. And then it's devoid of the Spirit and just functions according to the philosophies of materialism. And that's every single time. It always starts with a man. There's John Wesley. And the Methodist church started. My grandma was a Methodist. And now they're ordaining homos. Okay, it's just, I mean, they just are. Okay, so how'd they get there? I mean, a church that's struggling with embracing the transgender, right, was started by a young cleric at Oxford, and the name of his club where they studied the Bible was the Holiness Club. Right? When's the last time holiness was an issue at that church? Right? No, it's not. See, but that's just the way it goes. That's the way it always goes. It starts with a man, and then he gains a following, and then once they get a following, they organize it into a machine, and then it becomes more about the structure, and keeping it going. And then after that, you just got to keep it going, and all you do is you uphold the founding principles as a monument, and you talk about the great founders of our faith, but you're not actually doing or anything that they originally taught. And then before you know it, you're just trying to pay the bills any way you can, which means don't preach anybody out of here because they tithe. And you're just materialistic. And that's an oversimplification, but you'll see that a lot. All right, now when we talk about this apostolic age, let's just get into this a little bit, and then we'll bite off the rest of it tomorrow. How you guys doing? Got 10 minutes? Amen. Yeah. Yeah. All right. So my daughter said this year, I'm like, you want to shoot that antelope? Yeah. She's 13. She's funny. And she takes after her mom. And anyway, so we call this first age, we call it the apostolic age. In the book of Revelation, we call it the Church of Ephesus. Call it the Church of Ephesus. And it goes from 37 to 100 AD. And this is the first age of church history. Now, what's unique about the apostolic age is that the people that knew Jesus are still alive. That's why we call it the apostolic age. Okay? And what's the nature of this period? Probably no one says it better than that Thessalonian Jew who said, "These that have turned the world upside down have come hither also." They literally did turn the world upside down. They started with 12. And what's going on here? Here it is. By 100 AD, there were at least 100,000 Christians in the world. They went from 12 to 100,000, minimum, could be way more. They went from 12 to 100,000 in 63 years. That's pretty good exponents. And the highlights of the apostolic age is the rapid spread of Christianity. There's St. Thomas Church, by the way, in Tamil Nadu there in India, where he was supposedly ran through with a spear. And when Christ said, "Go into all the world," they literally went into all the world. It ends with the first imperial, that's the official persecution, in 95 AD. The last book of the Bible was written in 96 AD, John, book of Revelation. And Paul's doctrine becomes the doctrine of the church. That is, those are the highlights of the apostolic age. And now we already talked about this, but this Roman world here, one of the main reasons that, and we're not going to spend a lot of time on this, but one of the reasons, you can see half of my world, the other half got flooded. Right? This place got globally warmed. Anyways, one of the reasons it spread so quick is because it was one empire. So you had a good postal system. You had roads that connected all of the major cities together. You notice in the book of Acts that Paul always targeted the major cities because all the trade and commerce kind of funneled down to there. And then once he preached there, he'd go right to the middle of town where people from all over the district or the colony or the province were passing through. He'd get some of them saved, and they'd take it out into the villages. And he was very strategic that way. And but many reasons it was favorable to the spread of Christianity is that pretty much everybody, if you went to any school at all, you spoke Greek. So everybody spoke the same language. So there wasn't a language barrier. Unifying jurisprudence, standard laws throughout the empire. And so you didn't have to, there weren't different things that you had to do in different areas as far as legally. The other thing is that, and this has always been true, the army relocated people. I don't know if some of you met in the military, but that's one of the oldest stories in the world, you know? Yes, sir. Right? I mean, my grandma grew up in Chicago, right down the road from where they mopped up Dillinger's blood with their handkerchiefs. My grandpa was a farmer from North Dakota, but when World War II happened, man, they met on a train from New Orleans to Chicago in the middle of the night, baby. Right? That's World War II. Right? I mean, you got guys met a gal in Germany and brought him home, right? And the army's always done that, right? All over the place. Oh, now I got a story, but I'll tell you later. Anyways, yeah, I'll tell you later. It's too long. But the army relocated people because, you know, guys would sign up for the army in Britain or in Spain. And, you know, I don't know why, 3 meals a day and the work ain't hard. And they'd end up over here. And obviously, sometimes a guy would get saved, right? Maybe he's on leave in Athens. He hears Paul preach. He goes home to Spain, tells his family, right? And so that type of stuff, okay? And then obviously, you had major cities. You had a highway system. You had Jewish synagogues. You had scriptures all over the place. So it was easy to take the Old Testament. It was sitting right there. And then regular postal systems. So there was... there was good communication. That's the old Pax Romana right there. Yeah, the row and the key. It means Roman peace. And now this is where these guys went traditionally, and the material's pretty scanty. You got to really dig around for it, but and we don't really know for a fact, but this is traditionally where these guys went. Apparently Peter went to Asia Minor in the Middle East. John died in Ephesus around 100 AD. Andrew, the Apostle Andrew, preached the Word of God in Asia Minor and Greece and Scythia. That's up by the Red Sea, so that'd be Russians, Slavs. Philip preached in Upper Asia, Hierapolis, and Phrygia. Bartholomew supposedly preached in Parthia. They say he might have gone to India, right? And it was eventually killed in Armenia, where they're still killing over there. Matthew goes to Ethiopia. Thomas goes to India. Thaddeus preaches in the Middle East. Some people say Simon went to Britain. Jude was in Arabia and Persia. And Matthias is down in Ethiopia and up to Cappadocia. Literally, they went into all the world. Okay, but outside of Simon, really, the place that they didn't go was this way. They didn't go west. They mostly went this way. You see, it was Paul, really, that ended up taking the gospel west. They didn't go to the heathen. Remember what Peter said to Paul? He said, we'll go to the Jews and you go to the heathen. He substituted Gentiles for heathen. Now, the authority in the apostolic church, where'd they get their authority from? Right? Well, they got it from the Old Testament because they didn't have a New Testament. You think about that. See, this is why you got to be careful. You start digging around trying to find the early church, and you got and try to find what people believe and say, this is what we need to get back to. You realize that people in the early church had less Bible than you have. That's so it's very dangerous, right? You realize that you have more access to truth than people did before, okay? They would pass around just oftentimes just a piece of one epistle. That's all they had. You guys know what? You guys, I don't, probably no one gets the newspaper anymore. But that's about what the Bible was written on. Papyrus, cheap newsprint. How long does that last getting passed around person to person? They didn't have printing presses, right? They didn't have the truth like you have it. So when you start going and looking for the authentic truth, you know what you might find? A lot of heretics, right? Not only this, but you got to realize that that world into which Christianity came was completely shot through with Greek philosophy and Eastern mysticism, right? And Greek philosophy, obviously, from the College at Alexandria. And of course, you had Jews everywhere that were trying to mix the Old Testament with New Testament doctrine. It was a hotbed of heresy. It was a hotbed of heresy. And by the way, back then, they didn't have TV. So the scholars back then would run circles around the scholars today. And they're reading right in 10 or 12 different languages. They spent all day reading and meditating. And so they were not slouches when it came to philosophy, when it came to metaphysics and all this type of stuff. And so it was a dangerous place to come up with spiritual doctrine. Okay? So in the Old Testament, it was interpreted by revelation given to the apostles. And I say by revelation given to the apostles and prophets, that was the authority in the very early church. What do you mean? I mean that when Peter and Paul would preach, they would quote the Old Testament in light of what they learned from Jesus Christ. And they would apply that to people. Okay? And this is important because this is what churches today try to continue, but it stopped. To this was added some of the writings, hang on a sec, writings of the apostles. The last inspired scriptures, the Revelation, were penned by John in 95 AD, meaning after that, no more of the Bible was written. Now get this. With the passing of the apostles and the completion of the scriptures, the Bible became the sole authority. Meaning what? Meaning in this first 100 years, it was a transition period from going to the apostles and prophets and seeing what they had to say about the Bible to the Bible being the sole authority because the Bible wasn't complete yet. Okay, look at Ephesians. This you got to get this. Look at Ephesians chapter 4. All right, we need to let you go here. Now look at Ephesians chapter 4. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, and look what it says when Jesus Christ came up from the dead. Verse 9, now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that is ascended far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. Now look what it says. And he gave, what's the next word? That's what you got to get. Some apostles, which means what? Not everybody gets an apostle. Where's my apostle? You don't get one. They're dead. Right? That's you know a church that says, where are your apostles? That's why we're the church, true church, because we have apostles. God doesn't give everybody apostles. He gives some people apostles. Right? He gives some people what? Prophets. He doesn't give everybody prophets. You don't need a prophet. You want to know why? Hold your place there. And look at, now you know this, but look at 2 Peter. 2 Peter. And I'm talking to a guy the other day, it's been other day. Sure sign of getting old is when you say the other day, and it was 10 years ago. No, literally was 10 years ago. Good night. What was his name? He lived up north of Evero there. We used to do some work for him. Started with a Mick. He was Scottish, big businessman. I don't remember anymore. We're talking. I'm trying to tell him about the Lord. He says, are you a traditionalist or a biblicist? I'm like, what? And what he meant was, do you take the traditions of the church and put them on equal footing with the Word of God? You see? Why? Well, because that church teaches that when a pope speaks ex cathedra out of the chair, he's speaking for God in the place of God. And if you don't listen to him, you're anathema, meaning you're going to hell. Now, there's churches that believe that, you see. And guy's been trying that funny business for a long time. Joseph Smith tried that funny business, you know, and which is a joke, right? Couldn't even keep his pants on. Look at 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. Well, that's the truth. You got to remind them of that the next time they knock on your door. You know? 2 Peter chapter 1, and look at verse 19. Look what the Bible says about itself. We also have a more sure word of what? Prophecy. He's talking about the vision on the Mount of Transfiguration. This book is called prophecy. It's called the Word of Prophecy. And the Bible was given to prophets. All your Old Testament books were written by prophets. Now, if you go back here to Ephesians chapter 4, he says he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists. Not everybody gets an evangelist. You read about Philip the evangelist? A good example of that is this country in the early days of westward expansion. You had these guys, they were called circuit riding preachers. And people were headed over the Appalachians and going into the Ohio River valleys and even further. And there were people moving and they were spreading out on these farms and claiming land. And there weren't enough preachers to take care of them. So you had these guys called circuit riders. And they'd preach in a different church every 8 weeks. And then the other 7 weeks, there'd be a local guy that would go through a Sunday school lesson with the people. And their pastor, quote unquote pastor, would only show up every so often to keep the church going. That was an evangelist. Why didn't they have pastors? There weren't enough around. You see? That's an office. But not everybody has that. Right? You don't have to have someone come through. Right? You don't have to have Sam Gipp come through and pastor this church. You have Nathan Gipp. Right? Let them fight that out. Right? All right? Look what he says. He says some evangelists and some, not everybody's had pastors and teachers. Okay, now look at Ephesians, and I'll show you this. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, and look what he says. In verse 19, now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints in the household of God. Now look what he says. And are built upon the what?
Foundation.
The foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. All right? We don't have apostles and prophets today. The apostles and prophets are the foundation of the church, right? So Paul shows up to a bunch of people that believe that they have to keep the Mosaic law to be saved. You following me? He shows up and he says, I had a meeting with the resurrected Christ in the desert, and according to these Old Testament passages in Psalms and Isaiah, you're saved by grace through faith in the finished work of Christ, and the Jews say, stone him. And you know what Paul does? He raises the dead by signs, showing them that what God showed him was true. He said, truly the signs of an apostle were wrought in me. And so those apostles were given revelation, new revelation, and they had to prove it with those signs. That's the foundation of the church, right? Anybody that does that today is a phony baloney. I'll show you. What did I just say the last book of the Bible was? Okay, look at Revelation chapter 2. At the very end of the book, the Holy Spirit just accidentally puts this in there. Right? Look at Revelation chapter 2. Okay, now, so in the early church, there were apostles and prophets. They established the church. They don't have a complete Bible. It's okay for people to prophesy. You see? Now look at Revelation chapter 2 and look what it says in verse 2. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience and how thou canst not bear them that are evil, and thou hast tried them that say they are what? Apostles and are what? Not. And hast found them liars. Meaning what? The apostolic age has come to an end. You don't need them anymore. God used the apostles and the prophets to establish the truth in the church until the scripture was done. And after that, the authority moved on to the word of God. Now that's what you got to get. And you want to spot a phony baloney church, you spot a church that still says they're getting new revelation from God. They are not. That same book ends with saying you don't add anything to it. You see? Are you following me? Now look at this and we're done because I want to let you go home because I don't want to burn you out here. Are you getting something? Okay. Okay, well look at this and we'll be done. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1. So they're liars. They're liars, pants on fire, hanging from a telephone wire. Every one of them. Now look at 1 Timothy chapter 1. And this is what I want you to get, because if you can get this, it'll make sense. 1 Timothy chapter 1. Paul is unapologetic that people need to follow his doctrine. Now you think about this for a second. If you didn't have the Pauline epistles, how many New Testament doctrines would you be short? You'd be short a lot. You'd be short a lot. Look what Paul says in 1 Timothy 1:19, holding faith and a good conscience, which for some having put away concerning faith and made shipwreck, which means Paul tells Timothy in 65 AD, people are already swerving away. That's why he says in verse 18, this charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy. He keeps going. Look at 1 Timothy. Look at 2 Timothy. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 4. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 4. Verse 17, notwithstanding the Lord stood with me and strengthened me that by me the preaching might be fully known. By me. Over and over and over again, Paul says that God used him to spread New Testament doctrine. Now, but here's the problem. Paul's doctrine was rejected. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1. Now here's the third thing. I drew it out earlier for you. I showed you that Islam came in and kind of snuffed out a lot of Christianity here. I told you that Paul went to Europe instead of going back to Asia. But here's reason number three that it became the white honky devil's religion. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1. You get all sorts of stuff this week. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 15. Look what he says. This thou knowest, that all they which are in what?
Asia
be turned away from me. You know why today you go to a Greek Orthodox church, a Coptic Orthodox church, an Armenian Orthodox church, a Slavic Orthodox church, a Georgian Orthodox church, all of them, Iranian Orthodox church, and they're all messed up, and they're trying to get to heaven by following the golden rule and the apostles. And they're baptizing babies. Some of them are baptizing kids, or they're associating baptism with salvation because they rejected Paul. Unapologetically, they follow Peter. They follow Andrew. They follow the apostles. They don't follow the apostle Paul. Unapologetically in their doctrine. And he says it right there. He says, they dump me. They dump me. They dump Paul's doctrine. When? Before 100 AD. So apostasy started early. So be careful about looking for the true church in the writings of a lot of church fathers. You'll uncover all sorts of stuff. And so Paul says it over and over and over and over again. He tells Timothy in verse 13, I want you to hold fast that form of sound words. And so there's not much proof that primitive Christianity was that much better doctrinally than current Christianity as a whole. In fact, it was probably worse because they didn't have a lot of Bible around at all. If all you had was the Old Testament and the Gospels, what would you know? Oh, I showed you that already, but I want to show you this and we'll go home. I showed you that already. I did that on the... Come on, clicker. All right, here it is. The Apostle of the Gentiles. Paul was saved outside the land of Israel and died in Rome, 67 AD. He wasn't even saved in the land of Palestine. He was saved on the road to Damascus. And he didn't die in Jerusalem. He died in Rome. That's all on purpose. He's the Apostle of the Gentiles. He established churches in Asia Minor and the European mainline, ultimately bringing his gospel to the heart of the empire, Rome. He was sent to preach to the Gentiles and also to establish church age doctrine. His doctrine developed alongside and was meant to replace current kingdom doctrine, right? You got to get that. And the Catholic Church, the Anglican Church, and all of the Orthodox churches never got out of the Gospels. You know what the problem with that is? In the Gospels, Jesus Christ hasn't died on the cross yet, which means it's incomplete revelation, and you'll be a heretic. You'll be good to your fellow man, but you'll be a heretic, all right? Now look at this. Now, look at this. You got to think about this here. To Paul was revealed justification by grace through faith alone. That was revealed to Paul. He called it my gospel. To Paul was revealed the body of Christ invisible. You know, before Paul showed up, man, you steal from the church, Peter knocks you dead on the floor. That's some kingdom authority. The eternal security of the believer. You're hard-pressed to find eternal security of the believer outside of Romans, Ephesians, and Colossians. You can make it up, but it's tough. Baptism is a picture, not a sacrament. Paul taught the pre-tribulation rapture of the church, right? In the Gospels, there is no pre-tribulation rapture. They're raptured at the end of the tribulation. The pre-tribulation rapture was revealed to Paul. To Paul was revealed the temporary blindness of Israel, followed by a literal restoration. In the Old Testament, in the Gospels, the kingdom and the church were one and the same, which is exactly what the Protestant and Catholic churches believe, right? They believe that they're carrying out the will of God on earth, which means if you're a heretic, they can burn you at the stake because they're working for God. Well, that's all wrong because they don't get this doctrine right here. Now look, now get this. Every major Baptist doctrine, eternal security is pretty much a Baptist doctrine. You know that, right? Unless you're Presbyterian, and that's just because they're Calvinist. It's pretty much a Baptist doctrine. Only the people that believe it really are a Plymouth Brethren. Okay? Every major Baptist doctrine was taught by Paul, and Paul's doctrine was the doctrine of the primitive church. Now, people ask me all the time, they say, where do you find Baptist doctrine in church history? And they'll quote Tertullian and Cyprian and Chrysostom in the 4th century, and I say, I'll go 3 centuries earlier, turn to the book of Ephesians. You know where Baptist doctrine is? It's in the Bible. And by 65 AD, they dumped it. Right? I don't know what I just did. End of slideshow. Click. No, I want to go back. Oh, no, that was the last one, was it? There it is. Thank you, Lord. Right? Now look, why then is it so difficult to find Baptists in the early writings? Threefold. Paul's doctrine was not accepted by all in the first century. Ultimately, it was completely rejected in the East. Number two, Paul warned about the departure from the faith, said it was going to happen, and it was already happening in his day. So why would we be surprised if it happened when he said it was going to happen? Number three, many early Christians were burned, and their writings were burnt with them. Apostasy began very early on, as we will see. And what you're going to find is that Baptist doctrine survived, but it survived in little pockets. It survived in the mountains here, and it survived a long way away, where people were far enough away from Papa here to thumb their nose at him and tell him where to get off. And you'll find primitive Baptist doctrine in pockets, but in places where they're far enough away not to get burned to the ground. And so I hope that answers some questions about some of the very early happenings and progressions of the early church. I want to let you go, but if you have any questions at all, real quick, I'll answer whatever I can about that era. Does anybody have any questions? Ma'am. I made it up. They're all good. Ephesians 2:20? 2:19, 2:20, or Ephesians 4:11? Yeah, what are you looking for?
You said that Paul's talking about
some. Oh. Oh, no. What I mean by Paul, I mean that is that Paul taught Baptist doctrine. So Baptist distinctive would be baptism is a picture, right? It doesn't have anything to do with salvation, okay? Paul taught that in Romans chapter 6. Eternal security, Paul taught that in Romans chapter 8, Colossians chapter 2, right? Those are very clearly defined in Paul, even if they were alluded to earlier, right? And the reason that we know they were revealed to Paul is because Paul said they were mysteries before, okay? Another example is blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles become in. Okay, and that is the basic tenet of what we call premillennialism, and what that means is that the church is a temporary parenthesis, and when God's done with the church, he goes back to dealing with Israel as a nation. Amillennialism, which is 95% of Christendom, teaches amillennialism, and we'll get that into that in Lesson 3, the origins of amillennialism. They believe that the church replaced Israel and is the kingdom. Okay? And the result of that is that they believe that the church is conquering the world. Christ is conquering the world through the church. And then all of Revelation becomes metaphorical. Right? And so the white horse and the sword is actually the church advancing the kingdom. Right? Meaning a guy with a bottle of wine and some unleavened bread and a cross shows up on your shores and says, accept Jesus, take the sacrament, let me sprinkle you with this bird bath, accept the authority of the Pope, and we'll put you in the kingdom. And they say no. He says, fine, and kills 100,000 of them. Right? And they did that in South America, and they did that in the Caribbean, and they did that in Mexico, and 100 other places. I mean, they'll make the Muslims look like Sunday school kids. Seriously, you know. And so that's a dangerous doctrine. But that was revealed to Paul. So the rejection of Paul's doctrine led to the amalgamation of all that heresy in the early church. But it happened very early. Very, very early. And I don't believe that Christ ever intended the church to conquer the world. I think he prophesied that it wouldn't. I don't think he ever planned on, I think he planned on us being lights in the darkness. The closest we ever got was in England and America. That's the closest you ever got in history. And we'll get to that. But that wasn't because of the sword, that's because of the free preaching of the Word of God. But we'll get to that in Lesson 5. Any other questions? Does that make sense? Did I kind of, a little bit? No, there's no verse that says Paul was a Baptist. I'm not a Baptist because and you know this, your preacher says the same thing. Baptists espouse Bible doctrines. That's why I'm a Baptist, not the other way around. Right? A Baptist distinctive is we take the Word of God to be authoritative. Right? And so Pauline doctrine was adopted by Baptists. That's why I'm a Baptist. Not the other way around. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
So I worked with the Greek Orthodox and an amillennial. And every now and then I'll eavesdrop on their conversations and I'll pop up, well, what does the Bible say? And it basically kills the conversation.
Yeah.
How do you deal with people like that? I'm trying to what they believe.
Well, I know when my grandma, this is how bad it is. When my grandma, when we started talking to my grandma about the Lord, you know, and my dad asked her, he said, "Well, Mom, don't you ever read the Bible?" And she said, "John, I got Bibles in every room in this house." And they weren't Bibles, they were missals. They were Catholic devotionals and periodicals and catechisms. That's what they think the Bible is. But that totally would depend on the individual, brother, and where they're at. You know, that totally depends on the individual. Some people, you just got to get them to the right place to where they're willing to look at it. You know, but I would start with questions. Get them to talk, then you'd find out where they're at. Because it's different for everybody. Better let you go. I don't want to keep you any later. All right. Right? Is that good, preacher?
All right.
Good stuff. A couple of things. I mean, you get to hear him talking about the, you know, church going apostate, and you hear some things talking about new revelation. No new revelation. What church tells you there's new revelation? The Mormons, right? What church tells you they have apostles? Well, JW is, you know, Mormons can be Pentecostal. I'm down in school, and they tell me they got Kilpatrick, the 13th apostle, tries to raid people from the dead. He couldn't do it. So
those are gone. It's nice to know you have right there in your hands on the table in front of you what you need to continue on. Amen? All right. Let's sing.